हेलो हेलो
Excuse me, I am not joining today. Anirban here. Please don't call me because I'm in a meeting right now. Thank you.
Sir, what is your name, sir? Hello?
Careful, Anirban. Yeah, can you check with Uday sir screen share and Ashraful?
Yeah, sure.
Okay, can you ask Uday sir to? Hey, good afternoon, Uday sir.
Good afternoon.
Yeah.
Yeah, can we check, can you try to share your screen?
Yes, please, just 1 minute.
Yes, sir, it is visible. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, you can stop it now. I'll share my screen for just. So thing is, like, I'll just provide the introduction and then we can.
I think Ashraful, there are two presentation. I don't know, like, if. Ashraful. Uday sir, is it the single presentation or like someone else also to check?
There are two presentations.
Yeah. So who was that? Rahul? Like
Sai. Sai.
Okay. Yeah, Mr. Sai, can you check your screen share? Yes. Sai,
yeah.
Jagannath.
Do you want to meet to check or else how is it?
Yeah. You can check your screen share.
Okay. Just let me know if ever you are able to see the screen.
Sure, sir.
Are you able to see my screen?
Yeah, yes, we can sir. See your screen. Yes, yes. Okay, sir. Yeah, we'll quickly start because it's already 12:03. Sir, can you stop your screen once again?
Yeah, I'm doing that.
Hello? Mr. Sai, can you just stop your screen for a second? Yeah, thank you. Hello everyone, good afternoon, and I welcome everyone to this open discussion series, and I thank all the participants who are taking part today, and because of you we have come towards the session 15 of our open discussion series today. So today we are going to discuss a very important topic, and you know, it is mainly considering, you know, empowering innovations by Maxim Integrated. Okay, so along with me, I have Mr. Uday Pisute today, who is the director of sales from Maxim Integrated, and also I have Mr. Sai from Maxim Integrated, and along with me from Phytech team, I have Mr. Vasudev, the director of Phytech India. So as you know, I hope you already know me. I am Ashraful, the product manager of Rugged Board, and I'll be trying to moderate the event today. So I'll not take much time. So our panelists will have a lot of things to give you today, and I hope you'll get some benefit out of it from the presentation. And as usual, if you have any questions during the session, please try to write it on the chat, and we'll try to answer the questions after the session. Just for the people who are who joined recently,
Ashraful, we can skip the Phytech intro. It's okay.
Yeah. So I'd not take much time. Just I'd like to pass the stage to Mr. Uday. Mr. Uday, you can continue. Share the screen and continue.
Yeah, thank you.
Uday, sir, by the time you share your screen, I just want to share one statement. to all the participants, it has been a nice journey. And then, like, I know, like, many of you know the Maxim Integrated. So before we start the session, I want to share the small story. It's the story same like Xerox or Volvo and the brands which have taken the replacement, right? The people really don't very less call it as a photocopy machine, whereas they call it as a Xerox. So I recall my early days when around 2005 and it's around 15 years or like two decades before. I think most of you are embedded developers. So if you want to have a UART, you get a TTL signals on the controller, and then you want a UART, then you say RS-232. Then what we used to call is add a MAX-232 chip. So actually we wanted to add a TTL translator for RS-232. But most of the people used to refer it as a MAX-232, right? Like, so that is one of the sweet story I wanted to share. That is from my personal stuff. So that is how the Maxim has been in the industry since decades. And then like providing multiple of product solutions. So more will be shared by the Maxim team. Over to Uday, sir.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Vasu. Am I audible to everybody?
Yeah.
Yes, sir, you are audible.
Yeah, thank you. So first of all, good afternoon to everybody. We are in the series of Phytech to really introduce the products to all our esteemed customers. And today the session is divided into two parts. First of all, first part, I will deliver on the Maxim, how it is, and what do you mean by empowering design innovations? And then Sai, my colleague, who is a field application engineer in Maxim, will take you to basically the power section of it. So let's start. So agenda for today's presentation is basically, first of all, I'll introduce you to Maxim. Then we will also talk about Maxim solutions, and then we'll talk about Maxim advantages. This is the three things which I will talk in my presentation. And I'll take you to the segments where we are present, and we'll also take you to the segments where we are adding values by creating new parts within the Maxim. So Maxim, basically, it's there from 1983. And as Vasu mentioned, RS-232 was actually invented by Maxim, and it started its journey from there. Today it's a $2.2 billion company globally with 7,100 employees located across 34 locations. Our expertise in solving design challenges, that's what our company philosophy says. First of all is power efficiency and signal integrity. Power efficiency has become a very big challenge in today's world, where every small charge from the battery needs to be utilized in a proper way, and getting most out of battery life in everything from cars to smartphones to wearables, everything has become important. So one of our expertise where we keep innovating ourselves is into power efficiency and signal integrity. Ever increasing data rates. I need not to really elaborate what it means in today's world, but if you really look at the data rates which we have been gone through in the last couple of years, it is increasing. And we have seen, all of us have seen those days when we used to have a modem which used to be hanged to your telephone cables to some kilobytes to megabytes, now in gigabytes what we are talking about, and we are talking about 5G. So ever-increasing data rates is another challenge which all our embedded community faces, and this is exactly where Maxim also works. Third important thing is basically miniaturization. So miniaturization, when we see, it's basically everything, whatever is there, you need a radio size. You remember those cloud data centers, and you remember those big computers the miniaturization, what we have gone through in last couple of decades and what we are going through. So it is another one challenge with embedded community faces is miniaturization. And that's again the third point where we work. Environments are becoming harsh. Needs to have our devices and products to work on a very harsh environment. And again, that is also one of the challenges what we have, where Maxim focuses. And the last one is basically security. security is a very well-known thing, and it is going to be a very big segment going forward, because every other thing is going to be get connected. So many billion devices are supposed to get connected. And in those connected world, the security plays a very, very vital role. So it is again a most important area for us in Maxim to really work on. So these are the five areas where these are the five challenges which our end customer face day in, day out, and Maxim tries to work on those five areas where we try to get our solutions and our products around these themes. Now let's look at the industries and verticals where Maxim is focusing on. So first and foremost thing, these are the five verticals where we focus, mainly automotive, industrial. Industrial has been our expertise right from day one, and this is our bread and butter, which continues to be a major segment for us. Healthcare, which is a upcoming segment, and it is very, very important as we know what the way we are going through in this epidemic currently. So healthcare is another most important segment in the world where Maxim is focusing on. Communication and data centers, no need to mention anything. Ever-growing data rates, ever-growing demand of higher bandwidths are the areas where the most of the trending is coming from. And then consumer. So these are the five areas which we focus. Just a minute, sorry about this trouble. Okay. In automotive, we focus mainly on five areas. Basically, ADAS, power management, battery management, lighting, and infotainment. Infotainment is an area where there are a lot of things which are coming up in the world right now. Automotive, consumer, and governments are driving the rapid adoption of four automotive electronic systems, which is infotainment, telematics, advanced driver assistance, and electrification of vehicles. So Maxim products are currently, and the roadmaps will be actually which will catering to these four trends which are coming through automotive segment. ADAS and safety is one area which is driving the lot of security as well as a lot of bandwidth within the automotive, and it is stated that automobile in the future, in 5 years down the line, will be actually requiring the bandwidth and the data processing which is currently required at a enterprise level. So that much of data and that much of processing is required for ADAS and safety. So we need a lot of sensors. We need a lot of processing things to take care of ADAS and safety application. So is a case in electrification as well. So let's look at what exactly it means. So these are the four areas, basically infotainment, safety, powertrain, and body. And in that, basically, we are focusing on these areas which are mentioned here. I'll not go into details because it'll take then quite a big time. But then just to give you the focus is, as I said, is infotainment is basically there are a lot of displays and a lot of screens which are coming up in the automotive. And then you need a lot of real-time processing to really get into a driver assistance system or autonomous car. So you need those multiplexers and demultiplexers. You need those serializers and deserializers, and you need that processing which requires in the automotive to really take care. Those are the focus area from Maxim, and Maxim have solutions for that. In safety, you have cameras, you have lighting, you have power management, you have LiDAR. These are the areas where we have our chips on. And in powertrain, basically battery management, high performance analog, and integrated power. That's where we focus on. If we come to industrial, basically which is our bread and butter, this is the area which has grown over a period of time very, very analogically. Meaning, when I say this, is basically there is a very steady growth in this industrial segment, and with industry 4.0 coming in, we are looking at basically again a miniaturization and intelligence at the edge. So these are the two trends which are coming up in industrial segment. Miniaturization has really, really gone very far, and we expect that to be in a fast mode in coming 2 years, in coming two decades. So our focus will be on miniaturization. Just to give you example, so if you really look at the PLC, basically, in 1970s, and if you look at the PLCs in today, so there is a huge changes which has gone over a decade, and this is what the challenges which we face day in, day out in terms of getting our embedded solutions for our industrial applications. In the products what we are offering here in industrial are basic analog IOs, digital IOs, IO link serializers, then communication and industrial power. And basically Sai will talk about industrial power in details after this presentation. Typical applications in industrial: factory automation, building automation, and distribution automation. These are the typical applications what we have, but we are seeing a lot of other applications also coming up in industrial, which are into transportation, drones and robotics, heavy equipment, then power tools, security and surveillance, e-mobility, and test and measurements. So these are also the applications which are coming up in industrial. Another area which Maxim is heavily focusing on is basically healthcare, and the industry is going, or the world is going into a point wherein they are actually trying to see what a predictive healthcare is all about. Because there are two parts of the healthcare. One is predictive healthcare, and then when you are actually sick. So we are, the globe as such is looking at a predictive healthcare. So we have a solutions in healthcare in terms of power management, in terms of sensors, in terms of analog front ends and controllers. They say that basically it's a 10% of the global GDP in future will be around healthcare, and it is growing, and it will be further going. What I spoke about is predictive healthcare is basically when you, all these equipments which are available in the hospitals, can we have those signals on our wrist is the theme of the world, and this is where the world is going. That's why you are seeing those trackers, wrist-based trackers, and which are actually used to just give you the step counts, and then they used to derive calories burned, are now really gone beyond where they have a gyro or accelerometer inside that, which actually takes how what is the distance covered, what is the time taken. Now they are going further up to really have your heartbeat inside your tracker. They are going further up to have your ECG inside your tracker. So that's where Maxim is playing, and that's where our product roadmaps are all about. So these are the basically blocks which we are offering in healthcare, which are mainly biopotential sensors, electrochemical, where in this high precision long battery life is the areas which we try to cater to, power management, temperature sensors, optical sensors, and security. These are the blocks which we cover in medical. Just to give you a couple of reference platforms, basically we have monitors to really see the ECG, then we have heart rate, temperature. So this is the entire broad portfolio what we cover within the Maxim. Again, just a typical block diagram where you have basically wrist-based system where you can monitor ECG, heart rate, and temperature. But apart from that also, there are a lot of other sensors which Maxim has, and the analog front ends which Maxim has, which can help you build a solution around predictive medical wearables. On communication side, basically we play in all those areas where you have the infrastructure communication is products are available. Like we have a play in 5G, we have a play in high density data converter solutions, and we have ICs for lowest power optical modules. On mobility side, on all those wearables and gadgets, we have power management, audio, security, and signal path ICs to take care of consumer durables. So again, the trends are basically we are participating in basically making the devices having a longer battery life, high audio fidelity, and basically continued miniaturization. So this is what exactly Maxim is currently looking forward and working on. If you have any questions on all those, we will take it along with the other questions towards the end of the session. And then I'll request Sai to take care about power, which is the basic theme of this particular session. Sai, can you just take it, please?
Okay, thank you. Is everyone able to see my screen? Just let me know.
Yes, I. It's visible.
Yes, sir. Visible.
Thank you. Today we will be covering on this particular topic. As Uday showcased about our multiple product lines, and one of them we have selected, and this one is industrial power products. We'll be focusing on.
Sai, you are too low.
Yeah, you can. Can you come here to the device? Yeah.
Is it better right now?
Yes.
Okay. Today we will be covering about the industrial power products. As Uday has showcased about the multiple product lines which we are having, one of them is the industrial power products. And due to the time limitation, we are focusing just towards the industrial power products. And we have various products like even the battery powered application products or even these mobile power applications. And even in the data center and automotive segment, various kind of other segments are also already covered. So we are having the products for various kind of segments, in short. Okay, just we are covering out in this next half an hour, we will be covering on the industrial power products especially. Okay, basically the power is nothing but actually, if you say just an example for a human, if we consider human, I mean, similar to the what we say a system. System in a, I mean, industrial system or any kind of a system, okay, electronic system, in which power will be acting as just an energy to the product. So how good is your energy or else food you are providing to a human or else the system? This gives a better reliability of the product, in short, we can say. So how good we can participate in our those kind of industrial power? Okay, and here just an example of architecture in a typical systems. Okay, typical systems. What are all the block levels or else what are all the requirements? And here we will be covering on the left side. You can see those are the color topics. We will be covering up these particular topics. Just an example. System power protection is nothing but actually. You can see here actually, before connecting to the backplane, any kind of a system requires, because those are jacks connecting, or else in these connections actually you might see over voltage or over current or else under voltage or else voltage faults or else current faults, whatever it may be the reason, because when you are plugging up, it may be a reverse polarity connection or else direct connections during which various kind of faults may occur. So for those kind of things, you need a system power protection for these kind of products. Okay. And when it comes here, you can see here, we are having the power modules with an integrated inductor and even most of the components integrated in the single chipset. You can see here stepping down from 24 volts or 36 volts to directly for 5 volts or kind of a 5 volts or 3.3 kind of a step down regulators. Even we are having for 12 volts and 24 volts also. Okay. And then after isolated controllers, we are having especially focusing towards the 24 volts. And then after high voltage buck boost, what we say here is nothing but actually these are getting from the input from 12, 24 or 48 or 60 volts or 70 volts kind of thing. From there, you can generate to 5, 12, 24 based on your requirement at the output side. In this particular, you can see here the focus areas when it comes to industrial power. In terms of Maxim, we are focusing towards these particular sections, protection, isolated, and then after DC-DC, PMIX, and power modules. So most of the, I mean, almost all the power will be covered in this particular, I mean, we are focusing towards, we are not leaving any particular in the power segment. Okay. Just to give you a brief introduction of about the system protection requirement, here the voltage and current or thermal are the most of the faults occurs when you design a product. So basically giving a good quality of a product or else high reliable of your product. So you need to design such a way that actually your system should be able to capable of handling those kind of a fault occurrings. Okay. And what it brings value addition when it comes to our product. So we integrate most of the passive circuits and even the intelligence built into it. So such a way that you can reduce the form factor as well as and more reliable product you can make it. Okay. And our products can be used in even for 5 volts and 36 volts or 48 volts, 42 volts, 48 volts or else 24 volts, kind of a different kind of a product line, different kind of a voltage rail requirements. Yes, we are having a products. Okay, in this particular, today's we will be major focusing towards the 24 volts in terms of the industrial requirements. Okay. And these kind of a products can be used in a industrial automation or any kind of a distribution automation products, and even for a backplane kind of a requirements also. Okay, when it comes to voltage protection requirement, you can see here, basically, you can see whenever, just an example, okay, one second, I'm bringing out the pointer. Yeah. You can see here when you are plugging in, there could be a chances of surge. Okay, these kind of a these kind of a high frequency noise will be present in that particular one. Okay, these transients you need to protect. So when you are developing a product, your product should be capable of handling these particular high voltage transients. So these can be handled with our products. You can see here, single product line can handle completely these particular transients. It doesn't require any additional passive elements required externally. And even the reverse voltage protection is also there, inbuilt in the device. Okay, when it comes to the current protection, you can see here there is a chances of over the period, actually there are chances of wire breakage or else the insulation material peels off. During these conditions, actually there could be a short condition with other cable lines, and this could cause a problem of short circuit kind of a condition or else high inrush current kind of a currents will occur whenever there is a switching on, switching off kind of a conditions. And also there could be a chance of any example, just a high capacitor bank is placed at your input of your system. And during this time, whenever there is a connection, during this particular time, very short duration, high current inflow will be there. And these PCB traces should be able to handle these particular high currents. For these kind of things, what we recommend is that using this kind of a product, because in the earlier systems or else traditionally they use a discrete solution with a FET controlling the current flow from these particular FETs. Okay, slowly and gradually it will charge this particular capacitors, current limiting using this particular. But when it comes to our products, we are integrating this particular one inside in the single chipset. So even during a high hold-up capacitor also, we will be limiting the current using this particular one. Just to give you an example, what are all the our reliable protection product covers up? Basically, in the inrush current limit, as well as under voltage and over voltage protections kind of thing. Apart from that, thermal is also integrated in the device. And the reverse voltage and reverse current is also integrated in the device. So additionally, there is op amps and the discrete circuitry is not needed externally. Okay, these are all the complete, you can see here, this is our, just to give you an example, what all it covers inside in the single chipset. Okay, just a quick block diagram overview of our product, what it integrates in the single chipset. Okay, we are integrating even the FETs inside in the chipset and even the current sensing resistor also. So you doesn't require any additional current sense requirement, current sense to be monitored through this path. So automatically it is taken care of inside the chipset. So it gives an added advantages that you doesn't require any purchasing of an external resistor separately. Okay.
when it comes to the discrete circuitry, they will ask for these particular external current sense resistor and the current sense amplifier to be placed so that you can monitor the current path, current flow in this particular path. Okay, this is your input of your system, and thereafter this is your output of the system. And thereafter there are op amps inside in it. Just a resistor placement of through the input, actually you need to configure the resistor divider circuit for the under voltage and over voltage. And then after here, actually the current set limit, actually using this particular, there is a pin, actually he using this particular pin, you can connect a resistor pulling down to ground. Then after you can set up the current, what is the current flow requirement? I mean, you want to limit the current. Either you want to limit 1 ampere or 0.5 ampere. Yes, you can decide here using a, just applying a resistor over here. Okay. And then after, here is a flag. You can see here, it's an open drain flag. So it indicates that you can connect to any particular system like 5 volts or 3.3. It depends on your system, irrespective of the output voltage. So whenever there is a kind of an over voltage or under voltage or else over current, those kind of a faults, everything is represented to these particular flag pins. Apart from that, thermal shutdown is nothing but actually whenever there is an increase in the PCB temperature, so automatically you would like to shut down this particular system or else switch off this particular power supply to protect from your system getting damaged from because of the thermals. So just a quick overview of our high level kind of an information that we are having the products for 60 volts input capability until 6 amperes kind of thing. And when it comes to 36 volts, we are having even the 44 ampere kind of a capabilities. Okay. And these are capable of -40 to 125 temperature. And here comes your part selection table, just to give you an overview of with respect to your current and voltage requirements, you can choose the product accordingly. And you can see here, this is our earlier generation and the latest generation product, where you have a better reverse in the sense actually the time to respond, and actually it is in the 1 microsecond kind of a time duration. So whenever there is an input reverse input voltage, during that time within 1 microsecond our MOSFET will get switched off. So it will enable that, it will protect from getting damage to the other circuitry whenever there is a reverse voltage protection connections. Okay, and we have three different kind of a conditions where you can say, I mean, you can choose the product with respect to your own requirement, like auto retry, latch off and continuous. Based on various kind of a fault conditions, if you would like to switch off or else just auto retry after a T blank kind of a period, or else continuously you want to limit the current. So you can choose the product with respect to your requirement of the application. Okay, and just an example here, just a 1.1x and 2x kind of a current limit is nothing but actually in an application you have a 24 volt and 1 ampere, just an example I'm sharing. Okay, 24 volt and 1 ampere. In this particular requirements, you might have during the inrush actually you want to have a 1.5 ampere or 2 ampere kind of a current consumptions. Okay, because it will be a short duration kind of a requirements. For these particular requirements, we have a single device which can scatter for that particular high current during the inrush also. So our device is capable of handling even 2 amperes. 1 ampere product can be able to handle 2 amperes for that particular short duration time also. So our products are scalable for different kind of applications. This is what we wanted to say with respect to your requirements. Okay. And yes, of course, our products are already qualified for UL certification. So this helps your product actually getting for the UL certified or else your UL certified UFuse qualification for your system overall, extra certification requirements, all those kind of stuff. So our products are already qualified for UL 237. So simply you can replace the eFuse kind of a thing. Okay. Okay, yeah, just to give you an example of one of the product. Okay, this is a 60 volts input capability product. This is one of the them, and you can see here this is the package size of almost like 3x3 or 4x4 mm kind of a package size. And here you can see using a resistor divider circuit only the resistor divider circuit, you can limit the under voltage and over voltage lockout. Like if you like to disable your system whenever there is a 48 volts or 4 volts, 42 volts or 48 volts or 24 volts, yes, you can do using this particular resistor divider circuit. Okay. And then after here, you can see the flags actually connected for any kind of a under voltage and over voltage flag separately. So under voltage and over voltage, there is a separate flag. When it comes to current faults kind of thing or else thermal faults is indicated using this particular fault. So you can differentiate with respect to various kind of a fault requirement, various kind of a fault conditions. Okay. And here you can see here the resistor divider circuit, current set limit. Okay, and this is the current limit using which actually this particular resistor you can adjust from 0.15 amperes to 3 amperes basically. So you can just select here what is your current requirement for this particular applications. You can adjust here using this particular resistor. And then after there is an analog voltage will be also induced using this particular pin only, which can be connected to your ADC of your system, where you can monitor the actual current consumption, current flow in this particular path. So it doesn't require any additional things like op amps or else to monitor those things. And these current set, whatever the analog voltage you are getting, just you can monitor here the voltage levels. So to get to know exactly the power flow from current flow from this particular systems. And there is a T start kind of a pin. Actually, it is nothing but your soft start kind of thing or else inrush kind of a current limits where you want to set up the time period and how much time you need a inrush current and then after how much time you need to get a switch on to this particular system. So this is the T start period you can select. Okay. And you can see here, we have the products actually which are with the suffix A and B, C kind of thing. So various kind of requirements, like if you require only the forward and then after under voltage and reverse voltage kind of a conditions, you can select the B version. And when you need the reverse voltage also included as a part of the system, then you can select the A version. When it comes to only the current flow into the system, not the under voltage or over voltage faults, you are not bothered about the under voltage and over voltage, then you can select the C versions. And the added advantages like current limit accuracy, you can see here, whatever if I select for 1 ampere, you have got actually 3.5 kind of a percentage requirement, I mean current limit accuracy. So whenever there is a just a 35 milliamperes above and for a 1 ampere kind of a system, current limit system, so the 35 milliamperes is the up and threshold limits for the up on the upside as well as the downside. So whenever there is a just crossing beyond those particular limits, it will automatically get switched off. So that's the added advantages of these particular products. So very high, when it comes to competitions, actually this is a high limit, high current limit accuracy kind of a thing. So compared to others, we are more better. Just to give, when it comes to the higher current capability requirements, whereas from the previous one, actually both MOSFETs are integrated in it. When it comes to these particular 6 amperes kind of high current requirements, one FET is already integrated from the in and out kind of thing. And the other one is the NFET is actually the external one. Which is used for only for the reverse voltage, reverse current or reverse voltage kind of a protection. If you doesn't require a reverse voltage and reverse current, you can just bypass this NFET and you can directly from the current from the VCs to VIN directly. Okay. So this is the added advantage. I mean, this is for higher current capability, we couldn't include in the single chipset. So we have to add an external MOSFET for this particular one. And you can see here the 5x5N package. One more advantages of this particular chipset is, you can see here there is a power limiting is also there. So power limiting is nothing but overall power you want to flow this particular path, like 24 volts 1 amperes or 24 watt or else an example like 12 volts 24 ampere 2 amperes. So 24 watt you want to limit overall the power with respect to kind of a various voltages or currents, you can limit it using these particular pins. Remaining others are just as from the previous one only. Okay. Okay, and here just an example of isolated power kind of thing. We are having the isobuck as well as two different topologies, isobuck and as well as flyback. So you have one more is nothing but actually the active clamp. So for higher kind of a higher current requirements like 200 watt or 400 watt kind of a requirements, yes, active clamp kind of a configuration is also available with us. Okay. So what is an advantages of using this particular optocoupler? I mean, basically no opto kind of a configuration where you require actually additionally the optocoupler circuitry. Whereas when you use our devices, even we can eliminate those particular one. And we have got better EMI performance as well as the RF interfaces also, interferences. Okay, just a quick quick overview of the power supply. You can see here, there is a just a example of an isolated power supply. This is the input power stage, and then after the secondary stage rectifier circuitry, and then after you will be monitoring the Vout and sending feedback to the primary side to control the, according to the switch on, switch off time period of your transformer or else the MOSFET. Okay, so basically you need a feedback path requirement for a usual for an optocoupler requirement or else high regulation at the output side. So when it comes to our products, we have products with a no opto requirement. So you can eliminate this particular section. So basically we will be taking from the primary side feedback itself and then after driving the power stage. So this gives an added advantages of eliminating the space like this particular section, almost like 30% of area will be covered with this particular optical one. And it we can reduce using this particular, you can see here the form factor of the PCBs. Just to, we have made one particular product with a 498 and 690. So just to give you an example, how much area we are covering up basically. Reducing, okay. And this is one of the example of the ISOBUC. Okay, the traditional ISOBUC actually, this is our, you can see here standard, this is a traditional buck regulator, switching buck regulator, okay, synchronous one. Okay, in this configuration, you can see here primary, you can see here the output, we are taking the feedback from the Vout pin and giving through resistor feedback to the control system to control, switch on the MOSFETs and switch off the MOSFETs accordingly. So when it comes to here, we are taking, you can see here the, in the ISOBUC topology, we are just taking the transformer in place of the inductor and then after we are taking at the primary side. So, and then after controlling the MOSFETs accordingly. So we have got, I mean, we are having this patented technology, so which gives a better advantages compared to others. Okay, and this is one of the example of the ISOBUC. Just to, you can see here, the, when it comes to isolated power regulators or else requirements, you might have, you might require so many other external compensation requires. When it comes to our products, it requires a very minimal components, external components, and even the no optocoupler circuitry is required externally. And we can give you a better peak efficiency greater than 90%. And you can see here, the both MOSFETs are integrated in the chipset itself. Just to give you that no opto kind of thing, what we take actually the feedback from the primary side and then after control the gate accordingly. These out. I mean, what we do is that actually from here, actually K times of your V out, we are with respect to your winding configuration, we select accordingly and we choose, I mean, we get the primary voltage based on that, we take the feedback and control the MOSFET. So that you can adjust the Vout with Vout regulation, we can do this particular. So K is nothing but actually your primary to the secondary number of turns, K factor. So typically we are reducing this particular feedback circuitry from the secondary. So you can see one of the product just no opto kind of thing. Even in this no opto kind of thing, you can see the external components are very much minimal. Like only this is the decoupling capacitor to the power supply line and decoupling capacitor for the input one. Okay, this is for the internal regulator, sorry. Okay, and this is the set limit for your current, peak current limit. Okay, this is how you can take the feedback. We are taking the feedback of the primary secondary voltage from the primary itself using this particular resistor. Okay, and you can see this is almost like 3x3 kind of a factor. Okay, just to give you an example of, I mean, quick overview of the portfolio positioning, we are having the products from 36 volts as well as 42, 60 volts kind of a thing capabilities with a various kind of a switching frequency capability. And we are having the products with flyback, active clamp and isobuck kind of a various kind of a topologies also. You can see here the output accuracy without any secondary feedback. We are getting from the primary feedback itself, and the output regulation you can see here for this particular one. Okay, you can see here 8% and 5% kind of a regulations. Okay, when you take from the secondary feedback, okay, this particular one, you can achieve more better output regulations. Okay. And when it comes to DC-DC, yeah, what we give an advantages of compared to others, we are in very smaller form factor as well as we are better in cool in nature. Okay, and the built-in compensation as well as the FETs are integrated in the single chipset. Okay, just to give you an example, okay, here you can see here, and this is why we call it as Himalaya. Basically, it's our product line is completely, we call it as Himalaya because actually we use only the synchronous buck. So both MOSFETs are integrated in the single chipset. So we give more, I mean, we are more better, I mean, 50% cooler than compared to others. And the smaller solution size as well as reduced BOM sections also. You can see here, basically we say bye-bye to your short key. So when it comes to asynchronous, you need an external short key diode. But when it comes to synchronous buck regulators, you doesn't require any external short key diode. And this brings you an advantages of both of them integrating in the chipset and even reducing the form factor of your complete power supply. And even your active current consumption will be also minimized. And these can be used in any kind of a lower powered applications or else low powered applications where you need a high efficiency kind of a product line, product requirements when it comes to DCS or PLC kind of a thing or else motor control drives, okay, whatever it may be. So our products can be used in any product lines. Okay. So one thing is that, okay, just to give you an example, okay, here our products are capable of handling these particular IEC standards. I mean, it is capable of handling these kind of harsh industrial environments. And these are all the products are -40 to 125 degrees operations. So this gives you an advantage is that going for a higher temperature requirements, ambient temperature requirements also, okay. And you can see here, our products actually 48 volts kind of a, or else 24 volts. For 24 volts requirements, you can go with the 36 volts or else 42 volts kind of a 42 volts kind of a capabilities, where your spec requirements like 10 to plus to plus or minus 15% from the actual voltage. When it comes to 48 volts kind of thing, you can choose directly from the 60 volts product family. So basically, you can choose whatever may be there. You can see here for any kind of a digital input or analog input, okay, and for the network communications or else safety modules kind of thing, you can choose our product. And for these kind of things, we recommend for this particular transient input noise for, you can see here, using a TVS diode or else maybe just an example of a, I mean, you can directly apply to our product, okay, to without any TVS diodes also. Just to, if ever the transients are under 50 volts kind of thing, so you can directly use our 60 volts capable system, so which will be able to handle this kind of a high transient noises also. And when it comes to here synchronous switching kind of thing, you can see here non-synchronous switching, actually only one MOSFET is internally, and then after there is a short key diode external. Okay, this is just to give you a comparison between the competition and us. The ambient temperature of this particular system, you can see here, it is spotted at around this particular spotted system. You can see here 72 degrees kind of a temperature is using the thermal image. Okay, and the power loss is almost like 2.3 watts. When it comes to synchronous switching, the power loss will be only just typically with respect to same power specs only, we have just calculated it. Okay, this is what you can see here, 1.1 watt is the power loss. And then after the ambient, you can see the PCB heating is also is very much minimal, and even the 20 degree temperature is lesser compared to compared to the asynchronous kind of thing. So the advantages of using the asynchronous switching is that it reduces the power consumption on the PCB as well as heating. So it gives an advantages of going for a high reliable of your system. Okay. In the buck regulators, we are having from the 60 volts, 76 volts and 36 volts and 42 volts. We are having a products in different kind of a families. Okay. From 1 ampere to almost like 25 milliampere to 50 ampere kind of thing. When it comes to 5 ampere or 6 amperes, we have integrated FETs. Beyond that, actually, we recommend you to have an external FETs for beyond 5 amperes. Okay. And the peak efficiencies, you can see, just to give you a picture of one particular typical product, it is more than 93%. And just to give you a quick overview of the products, and we try to fit in the single sheet. Of course, we are having so many other products which we couldn't fit in, but to give you a quick overview of these particular products, we are having the with respect to various kind of input voltage requirements as well as the output voltage requirements. And you can see here, all of them are having the integrated FETs. When it comes to one of the 50 ampere, which I was sharing earlier, that requires an external FETs, which I couldn't fit in this particular block tabler. And you can see here, the programmable frequency, you have the advantages of going for one more advantages of using our product is that we have the spread spectrum. So when it comes to EMI or EMC requirements, the spread spectrum, because of the spread spectrum, we will be not using that particular single switching frequency, just to cover about around 10 to 20% of the switching frequency which we have selected. So the spread spectrum will give an advantages in terms of EMI and EMC performance. Okay. And the compensation is internal. So compensation is nothing but actually the loop compensation requirement. Basically, the instantaneous change in the load variations and the input voltage variations, because of this load variations and the input voltage variations, you need to optimize your control loop system such a way that you need to bring the output variation with a minimal kind of thing, transient noises. So for this particular one, we are having the loop compensation circuit inbuilt in the device itself. So this gives an advantages of not going for a, I mean, when it comes to the different kind of a systems, you might go for 24 volts or 12 volts or else 5 volts or 3.3. The compensation circuit is inbuilt in the device itself. So this gives minimal changes in the component level requirements when it goes for a different kind of a spec changes. And we have the preset output voltages as well as the adjustable output voltage regulators also. Okay, just we will be giving you we are running out of time, I guess. Okay, just a quick overview of the product, you can see here. Okay, just an input decoupling capacitor and the output decoupling capacitor, just an inductor external. Okay, these are all the, you can see here, this is all the minimum, low form factor when it comes to here, 3.5 ampere kind of an output requirement also. Okay. And when it comes to the PMIX, we are having the multi-output kind of a requirement, multi-output regulators in the single device itself. Same kind of a configuration, we are integrating all the three dies or two dies based on the requirements. We are trying to integrate in the single chipset and bringing up as a single product. So which brings you an advantages of reducing the form factor, as well as bringing up higher integration, as well as reducing the form factor on the PCB also when it comes to multi-output voltage requirements. So here you can see here for the high voltage, this is HV buck, and these two are the low voltage bucks. So basically from the 24 volts or else 48 volts kind of a requirement, you can generate 5 volts. From the 5 volt, then after 3.3 or 1.8 kind of thing, you can generate from here itself. So this gives a single device which can generate the three outputs also. Okay. And then after, we are having even the, just an example, for a typical systems nowadays, people are asking for a LDO as well as a switching regulator inbuilt in the single chipset. Yes, it is possible. You can see here, we are having a one, actually, there is an output for a LDO requirement as well as our switching regulator output. So you, using a single device, you can do the same, both of them in the single chipset itself. Okay, And when it comes to the power modules, what we say is that actually even the inductor is inbuilt in the device, so it reduces your EMI emissions also. Just to give you an example, what are all the in the power module, what are all it integrates, like power switches, switching regulator, and as well as the inductor and the other compensation and passive circuits, everything is inbuilt in the device. Only the external will be your decoupling capacitors, basically. Okay, this improves your better reliability as well as high power density applications also. And here you can see the form factors for various. This one is MicroSlick and this one is SIP packages. In the coming slide, I will showcase the the architecture of it, how it is internal architecture of it. Okay, here you can see just an example of it. We are having the products for for low current capability like 0.3 ampere, 100 milliampere to 6 amperes kind of thing in the single chipset itself. Okay, you can see here the just an example of the system in packages, how the integration and how the architecture is packaging is inbuilt in the. So you can see here the bonding wires and as well as the inductors and the capacitors, some of the capacitors are integrated in the chipset itself, the loop compensation and all those kind of factors. Apart from that, the bootstrap capacitor, you can see here, that's where it is integrated. Only the decoupling capacitors will be external kind of thing. So it reduces the switching elements are completely integrated in the chipset itself. So it reduces the EMI mitigations. So it brings you an added advantages when you go for an EMI EMC kind of a compliance. Okay, and you can see here there are three kind of a package sizes: MicroSlick and SIP, and then after one more SIP for a higher current capabilities and higher voltage capabilities handlings. And you can see here just one of the MicroSlick packages are just, you can see the package size, and this is a penny of 25 cents kind of a penny, you can see here. Okay, this is a smaller footprint kind of thing. Okay, and just the easy layout, which you can see here, one of our SIP package size, you can see here. This is for your internal regulator, the decoupling capacitor, and the decoupling capacitors for input and output kind of thing. And this is required for your adjustable output voltage requirement for a Vout. So you can see here, the layout is also very much easy to make in a two-layer or four-layer kind of thing. You can see a simple layout you can do in the two-layer also. And the total overall form factor, you can see here in the 1 centimeter kind of thing, even that is also possible to make a complete regulator solutions. Okay, and we will be sharing this complete as we are running out of the time. So we will be sharing this presentation. Just to give quick overview, we are having the products with the pin-to-pin compatibility products. Okay, and you can see here when you choose a product and then after go for a higher current requirements, yes, you can replace with the single product. I mean, using the same product, I mean, without changing any kind of a layout change requirements, you can directly choose, move to the different kind of a current requirements. Okay. And this is from the previous one, just to give you. Okay. You can see here the ANT representation is nothing but actually our form factor is almost like 2x2 and 3x3, 3x4x4 kind of a package size of the MicroSlick. So this brings you an advantages of going for a slim kind of a requirements, or else low form factor kind of a product requirements. You can do those kind of things. So this may be a thermopile sensor or else any kind of a industrial temperature sensor to be monitored. So here, those kind of thing, for those kind of a voltages, it will be 24 volts. You want to generate the 3.3 kind of thing. Yes, everything is integrated. You can see here the decoupling capacitor input and output. And this is the our MicroSlick module. Okay, we are having the products even in the MicroSlick packages. You can see here the size of 2.6 by 3 mm, 60 volts input capability to 5 volts kind of an input capabilities. Okay, and in this particular one also, you can see the input and the output decoupling capacitor, otherwise only just feedback resistors for adjustable Vout requirements. Yeah, here comes actually just a quick overview. I mean, this is my final slide, and here just to give you, until now we have covered these kind of a system power protection as well as HV bugs, PMIX as well as the MOSFET drivers, power modules, no-opto isolated kind of thing. So we are having the products catering to all these particular requirements. Okay. If you have any questions, yeah, I can take the questions right now.
Sai, there are questions in the chat. If you can clear that first, it will be great actually.
Okay, fine. Yeah. Okay, fine. Let me stop sharing my screen.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Sai, for your presentation. Yeah, just some questions are there on the chat box, basically. Maybe you can directly go through one by one from the top.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Just if you see, the first question is around 1217.
Okay.
Sorry, not 1217. Before that, 1215.
Okay. 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 Not only RS-232. Okay. I2C and of course those are popularized. Yes, true. Agree. Okay. And then after comes also the, yeah, we were first introducing the Sigma Delta ADCs. Yes, of course, that's true. And here comes actually, yeah, can we get the recording of these sessions? Yes, of course, you will get the, and even the slides of this particular presentation, you will get it. Okay.
Yeah, actually this session is recorded in YouTube. It is live basically. So if you want, you can actually get the recorded session always in the YouTube in the playlist. And also whatever, I mean, from our partners, whoever is sharing the PPT, we are uploading in slide share and sharing the link on the YouTube. So in one platform, you can get it. And also one more thing, apart from YouTube, you can go to our website, phytechembedded.in. There in the same event page itself, you'll see the recorded session link there.
And here I have one question actually. Nadeem actually has questioned me about actually, can you share the list of the ICs useful for the industrial automation products? And whatever we have shared right now is only on the industrial power. When it comes to the analog section like ADCs, DACs, and we have the very good products, recent launch of the products also there, in which even the integration of almost like AIO, we call it as, okay, digital DIOs. So where it is integrated in the single chipset, like digital input and digital output, or else analog input and analog output in the single chipset itself and from the single pin itself. And those products are already available in the website. You can feel free to contact us over the email ID. Okay. So we can share you all those details with respect to your requirements. Okay. And okay, whether we can use your product protection IC determined for maximum power point of a PV. Yes, of course, you can use in those kind of a requirements where you can select our current limiting kind of a current limiting or power protection kind of a limiting where, because when it comes to PV, most of the time it will be the voltage limited. So you doesn't require the voltage protection in those particular sections. You need to go for a current kind of a requirements. Yes, of course, you can do those things. And okay. When we are using a multi-output SMPS with an ISOBUS controllers, can we synchronize multiple controllers to minimize? Okay. When it comes to the SMPS for multi-output kind of thing, okay. So here actually the question need to be elaborated more in detail so we can dig in more and suggest you the exactly the requirement with respect to yours. Okay. Srinivas Rao?
Yeah. Hello, this is Srinivas Rao from MediQuip Services, Hyderabad. So if you can share your mail ID, we'll communicate directly with you.
Yeah, I will share you in the chat box. I'm going to share my details. Okay.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
The question, instead of SMPS, I believe the PMIC is the right terminology. Now, whatever the semiconductor devices for single input and multiple outputs, probably.
Yes, of course. Because when it comes to these, whatever the ISOBUC or else the no-opto kind of thing, which I've shared also, can be used for the multi-output also. Okay. So we need the more details to analyze exactly, to share you the exact part which suits for those kind of requirements. Okay. And how about the voltages for high voltage DC requirements? Because when it comes to the high voltage, these kind of things in the single chipset, like. Okay, this is from the admin Vistar Electronics actually. Okay, he has raised the question on the how about products for high DC voltage requirements. Yes, we are having the products, okay, which I showcased in the active clamp, which I was mentioning about those kind of things. Okay. In the active clamp, these kind of high voltages can be covered up. Okay, and can we use ISO converters and high voltage inputs? Yes, you can use for the for high voltage converting input using a series dropping resistors. Yes, you can do that. I have covered up the most of the questions. Anyone has any other questions? You can raise your hands and directly unmute your line.
Sai, specifically one small question. So in one of your converter, you said like you can clamp the input voltage by voltage divider resistors, right? Like so, wherein which up to 60 volts was their input, and then you said like it can be controlled or clamped using a voltage divider resistor. So just wanted to understand whether it will generate some heat and then like what would be the disadvantages or like any of the I mean to say it's more what on a long run what could be the disadvantages?
Okay. Because when it comes to the high voltage transients, okay, for a 24 volt system, the transient will be like 1.5x of your voltage level requirements. Basically, it may go until like 48 volts or 60 volts kind of a thing. So basically, our device is able to handle those kind of a high voltage, 1.5x of your voltage transients. But when it comes to the high voltage, like 1 kV kind of a transients, you might require external TVS diode to handle those kind of a particular, because it will be switching on and then after directly passing through the ground. When it comes to our device, it will be switching off the MOSFET itself. So no more current will be flowing through our device. So it doesn't affect even for the long run also, in short.
Okay. Thank you.
Balaram,
can you check one or two queries as
yeah, I've seen this actually. Balaram is asking about the isolated power modules. At present we don't have any isolated power modules, but in near future we are going to launch those products. Okay, yeah, Bhuvanesh is asking about the pin-to-pin replacement of TI-ICs. Not exactly, we are not having the pin-to-pin replacement because they have a different architecture and we have a different architecture. So we cannot bring them as a pin-to-pin replacements. Okay, because the loop compensation and then after two MOSFETs are integrated in the chipset. So that's the reason it is not possible to make it pin-to-pin.
Yeah, this is Srinivas Rao. I asked a question, I think, which was not answered. I said, do you give design support for designing, let us say, multiple output converters?
Yes, Srinivas, actually we do. And not only us, actually, we have a back-end team actually sitting in our Bangalore office. Okay. They do actually only the tech support as well as the design support to particular customers, or else if a customer has a good potential, we will be doing those kind of things.
Oh, excellent. Okay, then I'll be reaching you. We'll discuss.
Okay. Yeah, of course. You can reach to us. Thank you. Then after we can divert to that particular one. Okay. Oh, who is the concerned person and who is the regular? Can do that.
Thank you.
Can I ask a question, please?
Yeah, please.
Yes, please.
Yeah, if we already are using some other ICs, do you have a pin-to-pin replacement for such ICs?
can you, because we need explicitly more information on this particular one.
Okay, so I can contact offline by email?
Yes, yes, please.
Okay, fine. Thank you.
Yeah, I think we have answered most of the questions. If anyone have any questions, please ask right now. Or else you can ask in our forum as well. So as you already know, fightechembedded.in/forum. So you can go there and ask the questions as well. So if you have any quick questions, please ask right now before ending the session, basically. Vasu sir, you were saying something.
Ashraful, also we would request a particular application notes interest by the participants so they can post it on our forum so that like we can request to our partners like Maxim have a lot of good application references, say in industrial or healthcare and medical. So any we will be seeing more interested requests, and then so that like we can request the partners to present the same topic on a technical session. So it would be more useful if people start giving comments on your Facebook or like YouTube, or like you can directly post our request on our forum. So the more we hear from the people and understand what is their requirements is all about, we can request the same from the industry partners so that like they talk on the required topic. Thank you very much, Uday sir and Sai. And it was a wonderful session. Indeed, I have been user of Maxim since long, but like really this session also helped me to little bit more grow the database of my design components, basically. So our team extensively uses Maxim parts, but like this was really a empowering session actually. We request your support for technical session in future so that like we try to gather some interest from the participants on what kind of applications they are interested in, and probably we will request a couple of more technical sessions which could be a specific to a topic or a reference design or a application note. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Vasu. And thanks to Fitech for giving this opportunity to present our portfolio. Thanks to all the participants for investing almost your 1.5 hours to understand Maxim products. Really appreciate your time. And thank you so much.
Okay. Thank you all. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.